Welcome to the State of Biopreparedness meeting. We're really glad that you joined us. Know that you're a very busy group of people and appreciate your time and your contributions today. Looking forward to a really good meeting. We have an extraordinary group of speakers coming over the course of the day. This meeting is part of a series of policy meetings the center's had over the past year on topics of prevention, resilience, H1N1 response, and nuclear preparedness. And our next meeting is scheduled for November 22nd. Mark your calendars. It will be on global health security issues, and you'll get more information about that in the next few weeks. A very special thank you to Paula Olszewski and the Sloan Foundation for supporting both this series of meetings and in particular today's meeting. This month, we are 9 years out from the anthrax attacks of 2001. A great deal has happened to expand our understanding and experiences, our understanding of threats, epidemics, and biopreparedness challenges. We've lived through not only the anthrax attacks, but the response to SARS. We've learned from FMD outbreaks abroad, H5N1 planning, the H1N1 response. We've also learned from natural disasters like Katrina, the wildfires, droughts, and floods, the Haiti earthquake, other earthquakes. And these disasters have also put our systems that we'd use for bioresponse to test. A great deal of work has gone on in the federal, state, local level, and in the private sector. We've established new programs and had many exercises, drills, and assessments of what we've been doing. The purpose of today's meeting is to take stock of some of the most important biopreparedness efforts that are underway now. We'll hear from leaders and practitioners in the field. We'll hear what they've learned and about what they've built. And we also want to hear from them and from you about what we need to do next and the progress we need to make going forward. So to start the discussion, let me offer 3 points. The first is that the biological threat is serious, but our response is quite serious as well. Our intelligence community has told us that the bio threat is the most likely WMD threat to the country. We know that countries with scientific infrastructure have the capacity to make biological weapons. And the administration and Congress and all of you all recognize well that the consequences of bioattacks in the country could be quite consequential. On the other hand, we are not nearly as vulnerable as we were. Our preparedness continues to improve, and we're becoming more resilient with time. We're creating new defenses and barriers and programs which would blunt the impact of such attacks and natural epidemics. Potential adversaries now have to consider the steadily increasing likelihood that attacks will fail to meet their goals. Which brings me to the second point. We are stronger and better prepared than we were. It's useful to reflect backward for a moment about the time of 2001 and what was in place at that time. In 2001, at the time of the anthrax attacks, there were no state or local biopreparedness programs to speak of, no hospital preparedness efforts, no major efforts to encourage community volunteerism to help with crisis response, no serious systematic basic science or vaccine or medicine development program in place, no efforts at early detection of biothreats, no real awareness in the clinical community about biothreats, no microbial forensics, no civilian risk or consequence assessment process, no engagement in the private sector on bio issues, and no real prevention or response strategies at the highest levels of government. In 2010, we have all of those things, to some extent or another, to varying levels of success. We have federal, state, and local programs, we have biodefense leaders at all those levels, and we have private sector partners who are engaged. And we have all of you and your colleagues to thank for that. But that brings me to my third point, which is obvious and which is one of the reasons for this meeting today. We have to push forward. We have to make gains, and there's a lot of work to do. So, for example, in that category of work to do, there's a new federal medical countermeasure strategy that's been announced back in August that needs to get successfully implemented. There are new approaches to surveillance and detection that are being developed that need to be worked through and executed. We have to improve the coordination between the federal and state and local levels in preparedness. We have to learn from our international partners and think about ways to improve international collaboration on prevention and response. Our panels today are going to look at three particular issues as well on our capacity to dispense countermeasures. There's been a lot of work on this issue in the last years, particularly since 2004 and the start of the City Readiness Initiative. Given what we have learned over those years, what are the most effective ways to dispense on mass scale? What's the right balance between federal strategy and local execution and planning? What's the best role for public health or pharmacies or emergency management, the postal service, the private sector? On crisis standards of care and how we think through saving the most lives when we don't have enough resources for everything and everyone. This is a really complicated issue in America when everyone is basically expecting the full medical care that every hospital can give. But in an overwhelming crisis, what if there's not enough to go around, not enough ventilators, not enough meds, not enough beds? Who decides how they're distributed? What will we need from our political leaders in a crisis like that? How do we talk to the public about that? And on decon policy, the anthrax events of 2001 left many buildings contaminated, and some are still not in use. It's been costly and complicated, but there's been much done to try and improve remediation. How do we understand risks from contaminated environments? What would make cleanup efforts more effective? And what would persuade people to re-enter and reoccupy a building? These are some of the issues that we want to focus on today. How the day will work. You see from the agenda that there'll be a series of individual presentations and a number of panels. There'll be a lot of time for questions and answers and discussion at various points during the day. At noon, we'll break to pick up lunch. There'll be lunch provided for everybody, a box lunch in the other room. You can eat it wherever you like in the hotel or in here. And we'll have a great lunch speaker for you today who we'll introduce later. Then at 5 p.m., immediately after the meeting, we're going to invite you all upstairs for a reception on the top floor. It's a beautiful view. It's a nice place to have a discussion, and we'd hope that you would come up and debrief with us and speak with your colleagues more. So please join us for that.